We're about to resume. And this really is one of the most, this is likely to be one of the most informative panels of the two-day program. Much of the action is in the state courts. Now, we have a little bit of a conspiracy in some of the law schools that we're in which we create the impression that most of the action is in the federal courts. That is not true. It's in the state courts, especially here with respect to access to civil justice. And you know John Lippman, he's on the panel, and Wallace Jefferson, who is the former Chief Justice from the former Republic of Texas. He's currently with the Alexander Dubose firm, I believe. He's an appellate lawyer. He's also the chair of the newly formed Texas Commission on Expanding Access to Civil Justice, which is an initiative Chief Justice Hecht. And then we have an additional new person on the panel from Tennessee, the Chief Justice of Tennessee, Sharon Lee. We welcome you, Sharon. I think I mentioned earlier today that even if you did not go to NYU Law School, you are now an adopted child of NYU Law School. And we love our adopted children every bit as much as the others. So, Wallace, I'm turning it over to you.
Thank you very much for a wonderful program. And the materials in the book are outstanding and should serve as a template for what we can do nationally. I'm moderating this, and so I'm going to ask our chiefs and our former chief to speak for about 5 minutes each, and then have a dialogue among us about what courts can do, what they are doing. And when we say what courts can do, I'm very interested in what Supreme Court chiefs can do in leadership in their various states. And there's none better than the chief, former chief to my right, Jonathan Lippman, who we've already heard from, who is a native of Manhattan, and had his undergraduate and law degree from NYU. Let me just say that we have a conference of chief justices, the chiefs of all the states and the territories in our great country. All of the chiefs look to Jonathan Lippman for his extraordinary efforts in expanding access to justice in New York. When I wanted to expand our efforts in Texas, before my retirement in 2013 as Chief Justice, I called Jonathan and said, can you show me what you're doing in New York? And he was very gracious, and I came up here, and he had me meet with some of the lawyers in the private sector, had me tour the courthouse, and then showed me around the New York Court of Appeals to say what he is doing, and it was very uplifting, and we adopted many of those same efforts in Texas. His leadership expanded beyond New York to Texas and throughout the country. So, Jonathan, I would like you, if you would, to spend about 5 minutes and just talk about how it was that you were able to accomplish what you did. And I want you also to focus on, did it make a difference the way you came to the bench with your former administrative experience, for example, not having to run for office maybe, and did that help achieve what you were able to accomplish?
Well, thank you, Wallace, and thank you for the kind words. And Wallace and I used to, when we talked to the chiefs about leadership, they would say, how can you do what you do in your states with it and still survive? And the answer that we give is, you go to the edge of the diving board, and, you know, if you don't, if you accept the mantle of leadership, sometimes you're going to have some things thrown at you along the way, and that's the price of leadership. And so I'm delighted to be here with Wallace, and a great moderator, and talk to you a little bit about what I think chief judges, in particular, chief justices, can do. Let me say first of all, I think that the state judiciaries, and in particular the chief justices, are uniquely suited to provide leadership as the gatekeepers for bar admission, as the legal regulator, as the rulemaker, and as the people who have a podium, a pulpit to speak from. You know, I came to be the chief in New York from a little different background than most of my friends, the colleagues around the country, in that I, number one, was an appointed chief judge. You know, we have a appointive system in here in New York, which is gives you a great deal of job security if you have to run for re-election. And also, I spent so much of my career before I came became a judge as a court administrator, seeing the thousands of people who stream into the courts every day seeking justice. And it gave me a good broader view of access to justice and what we have to do to meet our responsibilities in that regard. We took a little tact to tell you in 5 minutes what's going on in New York and how we're able to do it is hard. But let me give you in a nutshell. On the public funding side, we put monies directly in the judiciary budget, and we're very proud of the fact that this year we reached the $100 million mark of a state public funding for legal services in the judiciary budget. And we did it by being kind of counterintuitive in our approach, recognizing that it's not enough to just say, this is the right thing, this is the moral thing to do. Because when you say that, the state legislature and the governor are going to say to you, that's great, but get online. There are lots of really good things and moral things and good deeds, but it's not enough. So our approach, I think, the secret to our success in some ways, was that we took a counterintuitive approach, saying that this is good for the, not only is it the right thing to do, but it's good for the bottom line of the New York State economy, for our communities, and for our businesses. And we did economic studies that showed for every dollar invested in legal services for the poor, $10 were returned to the state. Lower incarceration costs, less social services, more federal dollars coming into our states. So we were successful in that. We feel good about it. It's not the only way to do it, the way we've done it in New York. But I think that it public funding is extremely important as one of the pillars of what we try to do in New York. And again, did public hearings. We had the heads of the biggest banks, the landlord entities, the Cardinal Dolan, the controller of the state of New York, all people you wouldn't necessarily assume would talk about why public funding for the courts are important. The other main prong of what we did had to do with pro bono work with the bar, and to some degree, well, Wallace says how you were able to achieve what you did, to some degree, it's going toe-to-toe with our friends, and I use that word advisedly, in the bar. We all can be parochial at times, and I'm not talking about the New York City bar, Brett. We all can be parochial at times, and sometimes you have to reach out for the nobility of our profession, and if that means taking on the organized bar, that's what you have to do as leaders, and we always come together because the bar always rises to the occasion. But we had mandatory pro bono reporting in New York, which was a bloodletting operation to get to that point, as many of you know here. But I don't regret it for a second, because now we have the most comprehensive system of pro bono reporting in the country. And you can't chart the course for what you're going to do unless you know how you're doing now. And on pro bono, we encouraged all the different groups that hadn't been tapped before, baby boomers, corporate counsel, and in particular, the group that I think, and it's been mentioned here before today, that was totally not utilized in the past was law students. And that's why we have the 50-hour pro bono that, again, you would have thought that the world was coming to an end when we announced the 50-hour pro bono. How can you make those poor kids in 3 years of law school do 7 days of pro bono? Oh, my God, you know. And The follow-up is the nose under the tent for mandatory pro bono, and one for all lawyers. And wouldn't that be a terrible thing if every lawyer in the state of New York and in this country gave 50 hours of pro bono work to the poor? So, but again, it was a question of taking it on not being afraid to do it, not being afraid to go to the edge of the diving board. And then we built off that a pro bono scholars program where the kids do the last term of law school only pro bono work, poverty justice solutions, where we actually get money that those law students could continue on in the jobs that they have at legal service organizations through the good works of the Robin Hood Foundation, who's here today, and New York City. So the couple of other things in the 5 minutes that I'd mention, one is courts are rulemakers, and we made new rules for foreclosures and for consumer credit cases that we have a responsibility. Don't leave people just out there to fight this alone. We're a neutral, but you get a default judgment from the court, it better be based on something real. And the last piece that I mentioned that we're very proud of, and I think I mentioned before, that we really stole from Great Britain, was the idea of using non-lawyers to close the justice gap. And there's a case where initially the bar was nervous about it. Once we showed them that these were people who were doing work in places where there was no, where there were no lawyers, we weren't taking out the bread out of anyone's mouth. These are our housing cases, consumer credit, when 95% of the people are unrepresented. So those are some of the things, those are some of the ways that we were able to get there. And I would end as I began that I think state court judiciaries and state chief justices are uniquely positioned and have the leverage to be leaders in the access to justice revolution, and it requires us understanding that our roles are more than looking at the four corners of the cases in front of us. So thank you.
Thank you. And we're down in Texas and watching Jonathan do all these things, and we think, this is, how can he do this? And we're elected in Texas, and we're elected in partisan elections. And so you are on the ballot as a Republican or a Democrat. The chief is on the ballot as chief. He runs among the people, or you know, asking for the people's vote in the position of chief justice. And so you have their political calculations. When we decided we wanted to embark on forms and family law matters, the bar got, you know, was really angry, and they threatened to run people against incumbents. I mean, that's the sort of thing that we're looking at New York doing. Is it possible for us to do? Well, it is. And let me introduce to you Chief Justice Nathan Hecht. He's the 27th Chief Justice of the state of Texas. He's been elected to the court six times, beginning in 1988 as justice, and just recently in 2014 as chief justice. He's the longest serving member of the Supreme Court in our state's history. And he's a senior appellate judge in the appellate system in Texas. When I was chief, I asked Nathan to serve as our liaison to the Access to Justice Commission and to be the point person for Access to Justice initiatives. And when that announcement was made, I got letters, and the letters were putting this selection in political terms. How can a Republican be for access to justice? And that was sincere, that they thought that the whole effort was being threatened. But you will hear, I hope, what we were able to do under Chief Justice Hecht's leadership in a Republican Senate and Republican House with a Republican governor in making access to justice work, not only in terms of funding, but in terms of initiatives from the business and bar and elsewhere. And just one other thing I'd like to say about this. The chiefs are often told, you know, you need to be above the fray. Don't get involved in politics. You know, this is not your role. You should remain the neutral arbiter, arbitrator, and not get involved in policy making. Well, I think you will hear from this entire panel that you don't get that far if you don't engage in lobbying, in a sense, the other branches of government. So let me introduce Chief Justice Hecht and let us and tell us what's going on in Texas today.
Well, thank you, Wallace, and I second everything Jonathan said. We have gotten a lot of good ideas over the years from New York. We can't tell people in Texas that's where we got them. we just have to steal them because if we attribute it, it's not gonna be successful. But courts can absolutely take leadership in these matters, and as a matter of fact, who else will? Because in the other two branches of government, those who hold office listen to constituents, as they should, and often the poor and the cause of justice, sadly, don't have powerful voices to get legislative attention. So it's very important for the courts who recognize how important justice is to the parties that come every day to advocate on their behalf. So courts can raise the issue, they can convene. I found in the last 27 years that almost invariably people will take my calls. So when I called Wallace the other day and said, would you head up our commission to extend civil legal services, he didn't blink before he said yes. And putting a group like that together and really calling upon people who have to volunteer in a sense. I mean, these are people that don't get paid for this. And some of them actually don't even get their expenses reimbursed. But they believe strongly enough in trying to find ways to extend legal services to not just the poor, although we're working very hard on the poor, but to people of limited means is something that we are doing now. The commission's met twice. We're looking at lots of options. We have representatives from the academy and on the commission, and we're looking at everything we can. We think has a chance of working that will reduce the impediments to access to the civil justice system. Over the years, when IOLTA went south on us because the interest rates fell to zero, and they have been since, I guess, 2009, IOLTA, which was our main funding effort, has declined to just a fraction of what it was before. So we have gone to the legislature for public funding. We've not been as successful as Jonathan, but we've been wildly successful from the point of view of our own state. And the legislature really almost volunteered to pick up half the money that we lost from IOLTA in one fell swoop when they'd never provided public funding before, and they kept that up since then. Last session, they gave us the same $20 million, but they added $10 million for legal services for people for sexual abuse cases, and $4 million for veterans, which is a great shot in the arm for legal services for veterans. So as Wallace says, Texas is a very red state. We have an overwhelmingly Republican legislature. Our governor is Republican, and so these are very conservative people. Someone asked me earlier about how to convince, how to get support from very conservative policymakers. And I agree with Jonathan that one way to do it is to explain to them the effect on the economy. Certainly, just the message of the importance of justice is crucial as well. Enlisting business leaders, our Access to Justice Commission has had a general counsel on it for the last 12 or 15 years
It was the chief. It was the general counsel of Exxon for a while, who was not only general counsel of a major company in Texas, but is just an outstanding member of the bar, an outstanding individual. Now it's the general counsel of AT&T. So again, these are people who can speak to policymakers and tell them of the importance of access to justice and be heard in ways that that lawyers and judges are not always heard. When those people show up at hearings, as Jonathan says, and you don't quite expect them to be there, it can be a very powerful it can be a very powerful thing. Couple of weeks ago, LSC had its annual summit at the White House. A year ago, they had about six or eight general counsel from major companies across the country, which I thought was pretty powerful. But this year, they had CEOs, including the president of Microsoft, who, after the at the end of the meeting, announced that Microsoft is giving $1 million for technological innovations, and triage, and those kinds of things to improve access to justice. He sat through the whole meeting. I don't know if you know any CEOs, but they don't generally do law. They don't much like lawyers. And so I was amazed that not only that he would be there, but of the depth of his interest. And that goes a long way in trying to build support for access to justice. I've taken over from Jonathan as chair of the Government Affairs Committee of the Conference of Chief Justices. So part of my responsibility is to lobby the Congress for funding for LSC, I don't know that the roles of judging and lobbying fit very well, but you have to do it. The chief justices really have a lot of influence on legislators. That doesn't mean they always do what you say, but they do listen. I'll plug Senator Shelby this morning. He's from Alabama, but he is in charge of funding LSC in the Senate. LSC asked this time, I went over there with Jim Sandman, the president of LSC, and we said, these are hard times. We're going to try to make do with what we've got. Please just don't cut us. We recognize that you have hard decisions to make. Please maintain funding. And they said okay. And then a couple weeks later, they gave us $10 million extra. So we have a good rapport with the appropriations people in the Congress, and are trying to make that better. So that's some of what's going on in Texas and elsewhere.
Well, as the chief noted, these efforts cannot just be statewide in your own states. They have to extend beyond. There have to be partnerships with your colleagues in other states, but also you have to go to Washington, D.C. and talk to Congress, the House of Representatives, and to the Senate, and to the White House, and to the Justice Department. Chief Justice Lee has done these things from Tennessee. She has actually presented to the White House forum on the topic of access to justice, and has given a briefing to the U.S. Senate on access to justice. And we ask, well, how do you prioritize? How do you make these sorts of things a priority in your state and in the country? Well, one way to do it is do what Chief Justice Lee has done and make it her number one strategic initiative for the state of Tennessee. So they know, people in the House and in the executive branch know, that the judiciary is at the forefront of pressing for basic civil legal services for the citizens of that great state. She has been extensively involved in community affairs for her entire life. She was appointed initially to the Supreme Court in 2008, was reelected in 2010 and 2014, before that stint on the Court of Appeals in Tennessee from 04 to 08. I present to you Chief Justice Lee.
Thank you. I'm always happy to go anywhere and talk about the Access to Justice program in Tennessee. We are really proud of what we've accomplished. We also have stolen ideas from other states, but we don't attribute that. we are known as the volunteer state, and our lawyers in Tennessee really do volunteer, and we encourage that certainly. I was at a corporate counsel pro bono recognition event recently, and I was commenting on how well our Access to Justice program is. And one of the lawyers said, well, you know, the Supreme Court, the Tennessee Supreme Court is really the secret sauce in that, because you all are the biggest cheerleaders. You're always here speaking. You go everywhere speaking about it. And you all really lead the effort. And in 2008, we did declare access to justice our number one strategic priority. And it has been our number one priority since that time. We've got other projects we're working on, but that stays at the top of our list. In 2008, we created a commission. We appointed nine outstanding, well, first we did a statewide listening tour to see what the needs are, see what was on people's minds. And we already knew that we had lots of legal needs that were not being met. But we did the listening tour. Then in 2008 or 2009, we appointed a 10-member commission, corporate counsel, lawyers in private practice, law school deans, University of Tennessee, College of Law dean, and community leaders to serve on our commission. We gave them a one-year deadline to come up with a strategic plan. And they worked, they created subcommittees of also people who were very knowledgeable. And they came up with a plan that had about six subparts. And that was the basis of our effort. We hired a full-time coordinator to work in our administrative office of the courts to oversee the efforts. In the meantime, the court, we made a multitude of rule changes, our rules of civil procedure, our Supreme Court rules. I don't even remember how many, but it seemed like that's all we did for two or three years, study rule changes and adopt rule changes. At the same time, we were launching this initiative, the Tennessee Bar Association, the president of the bar in 2008 had an initiative, Justice for All, and he was very passionate about access to justice and still is. In the next year, he came on the commission. So we partnered with the Bar Association, the state bar and local bars, to promote our efforts. For example, in 2009, we had a statewide public service day where we had legal clinics all across the state, and each justice went to one or more of those clinics. We all continue, all five, we have five on our court. We probably speak at one or two events a month promoting access to justice. Some of the examples of some things we've done, we have a website on our AOC website, our attendcourts.gov website, which brings together all the legal resources available to people who need lawyers. We host training sessions for legal clinic volunteers. We've developed forms that are adopted by the Supreme Court for people to use when they try to represent themselves. And we put them through a process where they're in actually plain English, not legalese, so people can actually understand the forms. And because we have approved them, the trial judges cannot say, oh, we don't like this form, go back and start all over. So we have a number of those forms. We also have videos we prepared, posted on our website to show people how to represent themselves. I don't really like self-representation, if you can call it that, and I think a good point is made earlier. But there's some give and take there. I mean, I would rather have everybody have a lawyer. I'm a little resistant of efforts to train people to represent themselves because I don't think it's that effective. But at some level, I think you have to accept that that's going to happen, and we have to make the best of a bad situation. We've adopted a Supreme Court recognition program for lawyers who do more than 50 hours per year of pro bono work. where they get a certificate. We usually have a ceremony where we present it in different parts of the state. We also recognize law firms who meet certain criteria. Law students as well, after we started with the lawyers, we decided, well, we need to recognize law students who do more than 50 hours pro bono. And the goal there is to get the students used to doing pro bono, so then when they become lawyers, it's just what they do. It's a habit at that point. So we have a good partnership with all the law schools in the state for pro bono work. We have an aspirational goal. It's not mandatory, but it's aspirational goal of 50 hours per year. In 2014, the average number of hours reported was 77 hours per year of pro bono, which was over 700,000, or right around 700,000 hours of pro bono reported. We also give some CLE credit for pro bono work. Most recently, we've started a couple of programs that are new, and I think they're really very effective. One is a faith-based initiative. If you think about it, when people are in need, they usually go to their house of worship or their minister to get help. And often it's, you know, I've been evicted, or I'm out of food, I don't have money. And if the minister is trained to be able to spot these issues, he or she can go further and say, well, now, wait a minute, why were you evicted? Oh, it's because I had these tickets and I lost my driver's license and I couldn't go to work. If you peel the onion, layers of the onion back, you can often find a legal problem there that is causing this symptom. So we're working with members of the faith churches and different faith houses to train the clergy to assist these people. Then we pair volunteer lawyers with different congregations and provide them training. And we have a toll-free referral line where people can call in and get free legal advice from a real lawyer. And one of the most exciting things we're doing is we have a statewide pro bono website where a person who can log in, sign up, they have to meet certain income criteria, and then there's a lawyer who signs up to answer questions. So the person who has the need posts a question, and then the lawyer can post an answer. And what it does is it allows the lawyer to help to do the pro bono work without going to a Saturday bar or a clinic or showing up at a certain time at a certain place. You can do it on your phone while you're waiting in court. You can do it at the beach. You know, you can do it during a conference. You can do it anytime you want. You can answer the question. And, you know, some lawyers are hesitant to do a one-on-one with a client. They say, I don't know if I can answer the question. I'm not sure what I should say. But they're really happy to do this, answering it online. And I was at first wasn't sure this would work because I said, not everybody has internet access. I mean, where I live, I don't even have good internet access. But what we found is people don't have internet access or certainly don't have landline phones anymore, but almost everybody has a smartphone that they can access. That's sort of their lifeline. A member of our Access to Justice program had this idea, got corporate sponsors, doesn't cost anything. We've already answered over 11,500 questions on this system. He has shopped it out to the ABA, and I think we have learned this morning, 40 states have signed up for this national pro bono website. 8 more states are discussing and are looking into it. I really think it's the wave of the future, and it's going to be how a lot of legal services are delivered at low cost. So finally, basically, I think what we are sort of in this battle. We are the generals, and we have all these foot soldiers that we've enlisted, law students, law schools, private practitioners, law firms, corporate counsel, and they actually do the work, but we provide the vision and the leadership.
So we are doing amazing things, and yet there is still a crushing need. And so what I'd like to start thinking about in visionary terms, Jonathan, is how do we smash the remaining barriers, and how do we get closer and closer to full access?
Well, you know, to me, I indicated some of this early on in the first meeting in the morning. I think the different things that are going on around the country, whether it's the things that Sharon mentioned, Nathan, myself, whether it's the pilot Gideon in California, whether it's the program in the state of Washington with the low bono approach, all these different things I think, are this idea, and Sam had used this term before, of a thousand flowers blooming. And I think we get there by shaping the public view of this issue the same way as on the criminal side. People get it that when you're liberty at stake, you have to have a lawyer. If you had, people watch TV, everyone in this country, if you walk out on the street and say, does someone get a lawyer if they're going to jail, 100% would say, absolutely. They know about Miranda rights, they watch the television program, et cetera. What's happened because of all the kinds of things that we're talking about here and in other places is that people are starting to get it. 20 years ago, if you went out on the street and said, gee, if someone's being evicted from their apartment or the home is being foreclosed on, do they get a lawyer? People would shrug their shoulders. Today, if you went outside and asked that question, I bet 90% of the people would say, absolutely. What's shaped that difference in viewpoint? It's all the different interesting things. People get it, that it is important that lawyers matter, that legal representation matters. And we've used that term legal representation here, but as the book lays out, we've started to use a term that say legal representation, or at the very least, effective legal assistance. Because maybe there are some of these other things, whether it be non-lawyers or technology or ways in which you could get assistance that isn't necessarily the optimal. Well, you have, you know, a lawyer, that would be great. So I think we are getting there by doing the things we're talking about, by all the things that are in the book, by raising the questions, by being innovative, by being together. I think we'll get to the point where, if not by constitutional right, at least by policy, we will have the effective right to counsel. And I just said one thing that we did in New York. I think it's important to get people on the record that this is our policy. What we were able to get last year was a joint resolution by the legislature saying the public policy of New York is that every person who is fighting for the necessities of life is entitled to an attorney or effective legal assistance. We haven't presented them yet with the bill for that, you know, joint resolution, but it's coming.
Since the, I would say, the early 1990s, if your kid had an infection or a burn, one of the first things you would do is go to the web. You know, you look up, well, what's the antidote for this? Or what does this rash, what does it mean? People are engaging in self-help. They go to WebMD. And these days, it's not that dissimilar for people who are in legal distress. If they actually recognize that they have a legal problem, they're on the web. How do I do a name change in Dallas County, Texas? And they will look for forms and that sort of thing. Chief Justice Hecht, is technology a potential answer? And if so, how can the courts ensure that people are not being taken, you know, by charlatans who can put on a web page anything to direct them to for profit?
No, technology is making is changing the face of the access problems, because technology can help people it can lower the barriers and can help people access the justice system more readily. But we have to worry about that. I mean, we don't want, at the end of the day, to equate efficient and more accessible justice with cut-rate justice. We don't want a lower level of justice just to try to sweep away the problem. But technology is really an advantage. The Council of Chief Justices has worked on an initiative the last 2 years of using technology, in essence, as a massive triage utility at the courthouse to move people more quickly to where they can get their disputes resolved, rather than just assuming they're going to a judicial officer. And one thing we talked about earlier this morning on another panel was the legal system is very complex, and our tendency whenever we're addressing a problem of rights or resolution of disputes is to come up with the best system, the system that will work no matter how complex your case is. That's what they did with the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. Then all the states copied them, and they work great when no matter what kind of problem you have, it's a system that can address all of those. But small cases don't need the Rules of Civil Procedure. In fact, those rules can get in the way of small cases who just need, they don't need docketing orders, and they don't need all these other kinds of things that we just routinely use at the courthouse. So we need to look at ways to simplify the law and simplify some processes so that people can get a resolution more quickly. Now that Sam is, no, there he is. I was going to say this because he'd stepped out of the room, but I'll say it anyway. We need to look at the legal education and why we're training the way we're training, why we're teaching what we're teaching. Dean Ferguson is here from Dallas, and he has a goal and a vision for a law school that can educate lawyers for about half what a state school charges. I'm hoping it works. I'm plugging for him because it will be a way to provide lawyers with a training and ability to represent people that don't have the student debt and the burdens that a lot of law students come out of school with. So technology and lots of other things are very helpful.
And Chief Justice Lee, you mentioned, I think it's very important, commissions and task forces that the Supreme Courts of our various states can form. You invite people who are right at the heart of the problem to come in and advise you. And then what do you do with that information? Do you adopt court rules? Do you go to the legislature? Do you go to law schools? How do you incorporate the pieces of evidence you get to increase access?
Well, the commission submits their strategic plan to us, and then we act on their recommendations. Typically, it's been changing court rules, changing rules of procedure. I don't think there's been a time where we've actually gone to the legislature. Actually, one time we did to allow law clerks and state workers to do pro bono work.
What are some examples of court rules changes?
Limited scope representation.
Tell us about that.
Just essentially allow somebody to go to a legal clinic and help somebody but not be tied to them the rest of their lives, and it just eliminates a lot of conflicts. Long-term representation. We changed our court rule to about that gives people some CLE credit for a certain number of hours of pro bono work. There's so many, we've had so many rule changes. They're kind of muddled in my memory right now. Although we're the leaders, our Access to Justice Commission has really pushed us to do some things we would not have thought of. This pro bono website, I think it was a great idea. We wouldn't have come up with that idea. That took somebody with some technology background and the ability to line up sponsors and get that off the ground. The faith-based initiative came out of the Access to Justice Commission. And that's really, I've spoken at a number of churches about that initiative, and people get really excited because people go about that because a lot of people in churches or lawyers see that as sort of their spiritual calling to give back in that way. They may not be able to go on a mission and, build a house, but they can give legal advice. That's what they do, and they do it well. And we often see lawyers clustered in certain churches, but other churches, say in the inner city, do not have any lawyers. So we identify the lawyers in these urban or these suburban churches who are willing to go and serve in other churches to meet their legal needs. So they've given us some really creative ideas that we've been able to act on.
I'll tell you one practical thing we did in Texas is we the court helped to reform juvenile justice in Texas. And one way to do that is to form a commission. In our case, it was a committee of the Judicial Council to look and see whether Texas was doing well by its kids. And we were, just 4 years ago, ticketing kids for minor misbehaviors in school. And that led to expulsion and dropping out of school and everything else. So we put a commission together and invited all the stakeholders. And then it was part of my address to the state, to the combined state and to the governor in the state of the judiciary. Before that address, I talked to the committee chairs of the, you know, the areas that were impacting juvenile justice. And then afterwards, me and the committee would knock on the doors, and we would ask the chairs of the influential committees to sponsor the bill that would change the law, and then we'd testify. I mean, this is you know, boots on the ground. You actually get in there and work, build coalitions, make sure you talk to both parties, make sure you find out where the resistance will come from and try to overcome it, compromise where you can, but keep moving ahead. And, you know, they know who Hecht is and Lee and Lippman. They'll talk to you, and you just advance as far as you can. And in a two-year period, the hundreds of thousands of convictions, misdemeanor convictions, went down more than 80% in the state of Texas. I mean, I think that's what is possible. Do you agree?
Oh, absolutely. I think being proactive, the judiciary is respected. You know, we're not only more popular than the other branches. I think the branches know that we have more of a role as a neutral, that we don't take sides. So when you come up, whether it's a criminal justice issue or civil for that matter, I think we get respect and attention. And it doesn't mean, as Nathan said before, that they're going to do everything that we ask them to do, but don't underestimate the leadership role of the head of the judiciary. And I think what's interesting, I think Sam or maybe Wallace said it, the action is at the state level. You know, Chief Justice Roberts has less of an administrative role in leading, and I think that's changing too, to tell you the truth. But the action in terms of leadership of the state judiciary is where changes are coming in the profession, in our society, and I think, and I think we all feel that that we should use that pulpit that we have to get things changed, to make a locality and a country where everybody has access to justice, and it's not determined by the amount of money in your pocket.
What rules? Chief Justice Hecht for years, and still is, the liaison between the Supreme Court of Texas and the Rules Advisory Committee of the Civil Rules. So when there's a rule change, it typically starts in the Advisory Committee and then is presented to the court and then goes out as adopted. But there are rules, but there are also orders. The commission that you talked about forming, what kind of things can the court do to ease the burdens we're talking about?
Yeah, a lot of times courts have rulemaking authority. In Texas, we have very broad rulemaking authority, not just over procedure, but over judicial administration in the state. So, for example, in a day or two, a few days, we're going to announce a new rule on determining indigency, so that you don't have to pay the court costs. And this started as an effort to just kind of streamline it and remove some of the recalcitrance of clerks to accept affidavits of indigence. But what it has evolved in was a discovery that the counties don't care that much about the filing fee. They care more about the of indigence. Now, they care about the filing fee generally, but the number of indigents is small enough that it costs more to send the district attorney over there to fight the affidavit of indigence than they're going to get out of it. And they would be willing to let that go if then at the end of the case, somebody wants a free record, and now we're talking about thousands of dollars, they can revisit the issue if they think there's a legitimate reason to contest the affidavit. So that sort of shifts the the philosophy of the whole rule, in a way that I don't think we would have anticipated as judges would have been a good way to go. But when you go talk to the Association of Counties and say, what do you really want out of this, and hear what they say, then you can make some progress.
We are going to take questions, so if you have questions, if you'll go to the microphones, we've got about 5 minutes worth of questions. And as you're coming up, I would like to ask Chief Justice Lee to talk about the impact, and I'm not sure the extent to which you have forms available in various areas, and is that a good idea, and is it sponsored or approved by the court, or how do they come to be?
We developed forms in certain routine cases, uncontested divorce, some child support cases, just different routine cases, and we, our staff prepared the forms. We sent them off to have them put in, you know, common language, and then it states on the form that this has been approved by the Tennessee Supreme Court. Because what we were finding was people were doing their own forms, and the judges were just throwing them out. Some of them were okay, some of them weren't, but if they're approved by the Supreme Court, then they have to be filed, and we found that very helpful. One issue we've had come up this past legislative session is there's a real concern about expungements. Somebody gets arrested, it gets dismissed, but it stays on their record, and it keeps them from getting a job. The legislature was trying to figure out a way to pass a law to require judges to do different things, or what do you do about it? And we just decided, you know, we need to step up as the judiciary. We need to step up and provide some community education about expungements. How do you do it? When does it apply? Post forms on our website, how you can do it yourself. Encourage bar associations to hold clinics, Saturday court sessions. We have some judges in Davidson County who do Saturday court to allow people to come in, and expungements are a big part of that. So that's an example of where we provide leadership for people who desperately need the legal help, cannot afford to get it, and it's a big roadblock in their ability to move forward in their lives.
Many states have been moving forward with electronic filing, and one way to maybe bridge the gap in data is to collect this information as files are being electronically submitted to courts, and we've started doing that in Texas.
Wallace, I know.
Yes, question.
It's funny. So Amy Rahovchik, I'm with legal.io, formerly Law Gives, a codex technology from Stanford Law. Spent four years with the Thomson Reuters court data team. Anyway, the question is, we talked about changing processes and bringing in different groups of stakeholders to help, you know, just expedite the process. But what level of responsibility do the big law or large laws group or stakeholders have, especially in the context of their compensation plans, where they're paid literally to take as long as possible to do something?
So we're talking about big law billing practices? Is that what you're asking about?
I mean, we could call it billing practices, but it's a standard, it's the way that they work.
It seems like a question for Jonathan Lippman.
Yeah.
Yes, Jonathan now. What's the name of that?
I think the point is that I think the point is that we need to bring back down the cost of litigation. And yes, there is a responsibility at every level. And I think that again, when I travel, that this is the focus in a lot of places in the world. They're very, very committed to that. I think the way it's broken here in the U.S. is we're very concerned about legal services for the poor, but don't necessarily focus on the broader picture of the cost of lawyering.
Legal services
is
generally
too high. Yeah, the cost of legal services.
I'm going to recognize Dean Ferguson as our last questioner. Then we take a short break to the next panel.
First, this has been a great panel, and I congratulate the four chiefs who have done so much in this area. And I Justice Hecht, Chief Justice Hecht is humble when he says, you know, he got $20 million from the Texas legislature. That was a suicide mission. Nobody thought that could be done.
But he survived it.
But what I want to know is we do have this great council of chief justices in the 50 states. Do you guys have clearinghouses so that you can share, like, the great ideas, Chief Justice Lee, you brought up about your commission and its strategic plan? Are those things shared? And can you guys get the rest of the Chief Justices of America to do what you're doing?
Yes, it is shared. The National Center for State Courts makes all of that information available. There are a lot of activities going on. Just to mention one, recently you've read in the media or seen in the media problems with fees and fines collection in traffic cases and misdemeanor cases, and how the cycle of adding fees to fees and fines and ends up being debtor's prison. So this is something that all of the states are concerned about. The Chief Justices have formed a task force to look at that, explore how states are doing this, come up with best practices to avoid it. Yes, the chiefs are very active in working on these things and in getting their courts to work on it. I know... we all feel this way, but there are 9 members on my court, and I want to make sure that the other 8 have a chance to swing too. I didn't mean this way, but I meant swing at the ball. A chance to help out as well, because Jonathan says it's a price of leadership, and it is. But it's really an opportunity of leadership, too. I mean, why would you go to all this trouble to be a judge and, frankly, not get paid any more than you do if you weren't going to try to improve the system while you were there? So it's real. There's a price involved, but it's a real honor, too.
David, short question.
Just a statement on the sharing of data. I'm David Udall, the National Center for Access to Justice, and we've built a justice index that tries to identify what are the essential elements or best models for state courts in this way. And it's a very elaborate set of data. It's a database, really, where you can see what each state is doing on each of these models with citations at justiceindex.org. And the next version's coming out May 11th.
Thank you very much.
Please join me in thanking this outstanding panel.
Thank you, Wallace.